Hello.
Thank you. My name is Sebastian König. I'm here with my colleague Simeon Konzendorf. We are from a small studio in Leipzig called BlendFX. We are five people, like three partners, and we have two employees. And we do a couple of things, which I'm going to show you just very briefly. So we do architectural visualization, product visualization. For example, doors is a thing for us. I don't know why. We are rendering lots of doors for a company and floors as well. If we are not rendering doors and floors, we are doing a little bit of CG stuff. There should be more in the video. I'm not sure why it's stopped. Maybe I can press next. There it is again. So you can enjoy this again. And maybe after that, there will be more stuff to see. If not, I will just continue telling you what we do. So this is like some CG stuff. We also do visual effects, which you should see here for short films. So a little bit of compositing. We also do animations for TV and sometimes also cinema. But the other thing we do a lot is VR. And this is what this talk is going to be about. So VR is something that we really like, especially mobile VR for cultural applications. We've been here 2 years ago, I think. We had a little talk about one app that we did, Rochlitz VR, which is about a castle in Germany. And they have a room which looks like that. It's like very old and rotten, because they wanted to show that the rooms in the castle go through different time periods. And we have been reconstructing these time periods. And people in the museum can go there and sit in a chair inside that room and then put on their glasses and see how the room looked like. We like to do that a lot because we think it makes sense. It's not like just gaming. It's for culture. It's people learn something from it. So we really like doing that stuff. So we were really happy when we got an email in March or February 2018 from a producer. And she wrote, "Hey, I know your Rochlitz project, which I like a lot. Since over a year, I have been working on this project about Hotel Astoria. I just got the confirmation that I'm allowed to film there before it will be destroyed. I would like to produce a VR app about it, similar to Rochlitz. I even got funding for a story development. Are you interested?" Well, you have to know that the Hotel Astoria is one of the most famous hotels in Leipzig. It was built in 1915. Especially in the GDR period, it was a very famous place. It was a fancy place, like in Leipzig, in Eastern Germany, during the GDR period, there were not many fancy places, so like, this was the thing. Businessmen and celebrities from the West could then go there, meet locals. It had a nightclub in the basement, which was especially fancy there. It might not look like much, but back then, this was really like, wow. So people go there, especially the people from the West, and meet with the locals. There were also prostitutes allowed there, but those prostitutes were working for the secret state police, because that was a thing there. There was a lot of surveillance in that nightclub, so you have this fancy place, which was a little bit naughty as well, but then always the subtle threat about surveillance and the secret state police. So a super interesting place, which has been abandoned since 20 years. It has been empty and rotting along. It was like the holy grail for geocachers in Leipzig, or like adventurers who like to go in lost places. But it's really hard to get into it because it's very well guarded. And so, yeah, are we interested? Yeah. So we were happy to hear that Alina, the film producer, was inviting us to visit the place. And at that time when she wrote us the email, that was the stage of story development for her. She had been doing research about the hotel for a long time before, and now she got funding for story development from the MDM, the Mitteldeutsche Medienförderung, the Mid-German Media Fund. And this funding goes in three steps. So first there's story development. And with that you can then apply for prototype development. And if you finish a prototype, where you can show the funding board that how your app or your project will look like, then you can apply for the next and last stage, which will be product development. And that's where all the money will be. So we were really happy that they were inviting us to collaborate with them, especially since they would do the paperwork. Because applying for funding involves a lot of bureaucracy and paperwork. So yeah, we were lucky that this would be done by Alina Syranek and Falk Schuster. So from Hack Films, that's the film company, and they are the producers. And they are doing two things. The one thing is an animated documentary, where they will animate and like a collage of interviews and snippets. And the other thing will be the virtual reality app. And both of these will not tell like a straight storyline or the story of one person, but they want to capture like the essence of the hotel and the how it was like being in that time period and experiencing that nightclub. So it's storytelling through story fragments, so to say. So our job was to build an app that will transform you and bring you to that place, but where you can also explore and watch different elements from that time. So March 2018, that was the stage of story development, and the production couldn't start yet, but we got the chance to visit the Astoria. So I will hand over to Simeon now.
So I'm Simeon, and as you heard, we are very infected by the idea to create the Astoria in the 80s, and we have the chance to visit this place, but only for some hours, so we have to be prepared. So we have to rent a good camera, we have to prepare because there will be no light, there's no power source in this room, and we have to wear helmets, and this is the day 14 days later after the email where we wear the Blender branded helmet. And yes, we got a chance to visit this place, and here's a little video snippet where you see some parts of this day. That's the moment we entered the nightclub. And as you can see, there's nothing more in. You see the paintings on the walls, but no tables and, yes, no carpet, nothing. A very rotten place. And then we started in preparing our equipment. Here you see the special lamps we built. These are battery-powered floodlights pointing downwards to a big paper lamp. And this big point lamps, as you know, give us the chance to not have hard shadows in the whole area. It's a very soft, lightened area, and it's especially important to take photos without shadows, to use them as textures laterwards. And most important, the textures have been on the walls. They are from a painter who made them in the 80s. And yes, Falk take care of these to preserve these pictures for our app and also for the future. At this point, we gathered all the information we could from this room, but still there was no money for us. We have to wait until the next 6 months if there's a positive message from the MDM saying, okay, Alina convinced us about the story, now start the prototype. And in end of 2018, we get a message or a phone call from Alina saying, okay, they liked the idea of reconstructing the Astoria, let's start this prototype.
So in October, we got the message that we could continue working on it, and then we did a little bit of planning. And then in winter, like November, December 2018, we started building that thing. So when I was there, I took precise measurements with an industry standard note-taking device. So I could have all the reference and heights and everything. So I could start reconstructing the room. Not the entire hotel, of course, just the nightclub and the bar. I had an old ground plan that I could use as a reference, and I used that to build the bar. Also, we prepared the textures in Lightroom before, especially the paintings, to clear it up a little bit, so that we could then project them on the wall with Blender texture painting. And you might wonder why we didn't just use photogrammetry, which is like a thing. You can do that, press a button, sort of, with laser scanning, and then you have the entire room. But yeah, then you also have just a very crappy model with lots of vertices, which you have to clean up in the end. And since we wanted to reconstruct the building like it was like back then, like when it was still intact, we had to remodel everything anyway, so we could just as well build it right from scratch. And the room was so easy to build that it was quite straightforward anyway. Also, we want to go to a game engine with the architecture, so you have to have clean geometry then, so you have to model it anyway. And of course, we did it in 2.80. I mean, what's good enough for the Spring team will be good enough for us, I assumed, and I wasn't mistaken, because everything was quite fine. Is it stable? I mean, in winter, that was not even better stage. Yeah, it was... It was all right. There were some problems, but it went well. And also, we wanted to be future-proof because we knew that this project might go on for a long time. So we want to have all the good stuff from 2.80, of course. And it's not like Blender is unstable or more unstable than other software. In fact, Blender 2.80 in Alpha was still quite stable, working, not many crashes there. Working and reconstructing the room was kind of a detective game for us, so there were not that many references, and we didn't really know how these lamps, for instance, looked like exactly, or what's that thing, the pattern on that thing there. We didn't know, so we had to dive in some references. Also, that wooden thing in the middle was totally unclear to us. What is it? It doesn't really fit there. But it was a thing where you put glasses and stuff on. And we had to dive into some private photo albums from the former personnel to really figure out how that stuff looked like. Also, Alina had been doing lots of research, and they talked to the former personnel, and some of them had some props and some things there from the hotel, so you could take pictures of this weird snail cutlery or glasses. So yeah, we reconstructed the room and all the assets with Blender 2.8 AD, and that it went well. In November, December, and January, there were some issues. I didn't really know how to use the collections and do the hide from viewport, hide render, blah, so I was lost. There were also some bugs which made me like struggle a bit, but thanks to the developers and the fabricator side, those issues were solved quite quickly. So yeah, I really started to love Blender 2.80 a lot, especially the collections. Like in this hotel room where we have all these assets and details, doing this with layers in 2.70 would be like a nightmare. So thanks for the collections in Blender 2.80. One thing that we are missing, sadly still, is equirectangular rendering in Eevee. I mean, Eevee is nice, but we have to output stereo images, equirectangular, and we didn't have that. Also not spherical stereo rendering, which is very important for us. So maybe in the future with Eevee, but since until then, we will use cycles. Now, just briefly about our 3D workflow for VR. So the app will be for a mobile device, so we can't have like that much geometry. So we are pre-rendering everything into 3D 360 stereo panoramas like that. Obviously not in anaglyph, but in top-bottom format. And we want to be able to exchange some elements. It should be an interactive app after all. So what we do is to have like first our equirectangular camera, and then we use a perspective camera with a very narrow field of view, And then we can just render a snippet from that. And within that area that this camera is rendering, we can then change objects and render that. So one thing that is important if you do that, don't forget spherical stereo. It's important to have a seamless match. But that allows us to have like small like interactive elements, people drinking beer, and we can just blend that in with the panorama in the game engine. And this is the interactive part that now Simeon will talk about.
So now we have these beautiful renderings, panorama renderings out from Blender, but Blender is currently not able to create virtual reality apps with interactivity. So I choose Unity as my game engine. And you see on this side, on your left side, this is the something like the editor view, the scene view. And on the right side, you see the game view, what the user would see. I don't start with the spherical renderings because they will appear laterwards. At first, I also import a low poly or a base mesh model from the hotel so that I have a reference in Unity where to place the sound objects or other objects. Basically, when I have or at first, when I start with the base model, I start with the VR device and search for the best positions where we want to render. So I go through the room, or I transport through the room and say, this is a good position to see the pictures on the wall or to sit on the table. I gave these positions to Blender back, and then we render the positions. And this looks like this. Actually, I disabled now the whole mesh, and you see that the camera position is just inside on a sphere, but some objects are real-time or the spatial audio sources, and you see there's the ball above, the tiny ball. This is the disco ball, and he's rotating, so he's this is a real-time object, so everything which should be moving or which you should interact, these are still 3D objects with the sphere. When I move the position from one point to another point, I also move the camera and the sphere, though I always work in absolute space. Same for the positional of interactive objects on a table. I take the table from Blender, import it in Unity, then I can place the interactive objects on the table, and on runtime, I remove the table just, or disable the table, and it gets in front of the sphere, like you see here. Actually, it's just floating objects in front of a sphere, but from the user perspective, it looks like they are lying on the table. You have to cheat a little bit, like the shadows on the for the cigarettes, I just use a blob shadow, which is a transparent shadow, but this gives you the illusion that it's really lying on a ground. Let's see this in action. This is an original receipt we got from the employees. And I copy the rotation of the controller that you can investigate the objects. Yes, we just don't want to have only 3D objects. We also want to have testimonial, something like a testimonial in our app. We want to add a character and not a game character. It wouldn't fit. We want to have a real person which worked at the Astoria, which are still alive. And this person, Mr. C, was a bartender or a bar mixer in the old times. And he worked for many years in Astoria. And that, as we knew that there is a person and he want to work with us, we had to prepare for this this recording from Mr. C in front of a green screen. So we ordered the green screen you see behind him, we ordered the lights and make many testing, and the most important part is the stereoscopical camera. And there's something special about it because normally you would say, okay, take two DSLR or something similar and make a stereoscopical recording, but because our eyes are in a certain distance of 0.3 centimeters, these cameras must be very narrow okay, could be achieved with some lenses, but we have a very, very wide field of view. I want the person standing 1 meter in front of me. That means a field of view of over 90 degrees. And the lenses, wide angle lenses, are very big. We choose these cameras. These are from Yi, 4K Plus is the model. We 3D printed our own rig. And these cameras have great features like 4,000 by 3,000 resolution and very wide angle, and we can playback via Python script. It was a good choice to take these, and this is the output. The camera standing 1 meter just in front of the person, which is Falk, and he was my test person. And yes, we have this really, I would compare it like we built cameras as they were our eyes. Yes, we have to be very near to the reality, and also the camera height where we film must be exact the same camera height than we render the images. Then you get the perfect illusion, like the rendering Sebastian described. We make a perspective cutout from reality. And this is, you have to do some compositing, like keying, and then there are not good video codecs with alpha support which are running on mobile devices, so we have to build in the key in the video file, and the rest makes the shader. So you have color left eye, color right eye, and mask left eye, mask right eye. And the shader combines this for Unity. And yes, when we prepared for some weeks for this special day, we invited Mr. C to come to us in our office, and we did the recording, and in the middle there's our technical most important part, the tiny setup for the camera, and we had a great day, and he also mixes us a cocktail he mixes 20 years ago called Grüne Wiese, which is a green cocktail, which is funny in front of a green screen, but because it was in front of him, it was just a masking job. And that's what it looked like in Unity. You see, we are showing a plane in front of a sphere. Sounds very simple, but the illusion is like this. If you not look to him, he makes some noise.
Guten Abend.
Good evening. I'm standing behind you.
Herzlich willkommen in der Nachtbar. Ich habe viele Jahre hier am Astoria als Barkeeper gearbeitet. Greifen Sie zu. Sehen Sie es selbst. Das ist die Nachtbar von 1986.
Yeah. Thank you. Now the part of the, yes, we made an app that people liked and they could interact with it, and what's next?
Yeah, so once we finished the prototype, Alina went to the funding board and showed it to them, and then they had a little bit of discussion, and then you have to wait for a few weeks, and then we finally got the message, yes, you will get the funding. So we can now produce like the thing, like the product, which is super great. Something that we didn't mention yet, though, is that we are producing for a special device, which is the Oculus Go, which is a very nice device. It looks good, it feels good, the interaction is great, so everything is really nice, except for Oculus. Like we need a kiosk mode where you don't have to, where the user doesn't have to interact with the Oculus interface. So we just want to start our app, and then you will never leave it. You can of course leave the and get rid of the HMD, but you don't have to interact with the Oculus interface. Sadly, they don't listen, so if you listen now, please, kiosk mode is super important for us. Anyway, we might switch to a different device if they don't listen to us. So, we got more money now, which is super great. We can now start working. We have a little bit over half a year of time to produce more rooms, like the bar is missing, and then another part of the bar is missing. We want to add more details, of course, more interactivity. And during that phase of working half a year, maybe more Blender features would be nice. Maybe we get some. Like, for instance, spherical stereo in Eevee would be great. someone's listening, or VR in Blender. I mean, we are all in Blender, of course, but like virtual reality in Blender would be super great. And apparently it's happening. So Julian Eisel is working on it. Today we had a little meeting about the future of VR in Blender. So there is a team working on virtual reality interaction right inside Blender, which for us would be, of course, amazing, because we don't want to always go to Unity and have to interact with that game engine. It would be nice to stay right inside Blender to do all these things that you have to do, to plan your scene and place your objects. So, thank you, but no. So there is a project going on, and Simeon might want to talk a little bit more about that. We still have like 29 seconds.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
But just for 25 minutes. That's the sound from Windows Mixed Reality starting at VR session. This is a demo I did for Julian Eisel, where I test the OpenXR branch, which is currently only a special. You have to compile it yourself. But as Sebastian said, it was so interesting to meet these people like Julian Eisel and Dalia Felinto and William and the Ubisoft guys. And I'm really looking forward to this because we need it stable and usable. We need the material preview. We need controller input for transformations.
Sorry.
And the option to disable position tracking. But we talked to them about all these features, and I'm really convinced that we are getting the best VR tool with Blender in the next months and years. Really, they have a great vision, and this will be awesome. Yes.
So, no, thank you. Just to wrap it all up, so what we are producing is like something like a digital time travel documentary, I would call it. So it all started with one Polaroid, one photo that someone back there in 1986 took, and then through lots of effort and interviews and research, it ended up in this future VR app, which we are really happy to produce. It's been a lot of fun working with Blender 2.8. It's going to be even more fun once we get the VR tools in Blender. The producers are nice. Alina and Falk are really nice to work with. So that's it's a great project. And part of that was also like going to that place, like back in time, in a basement, which in an abandoned building. Super interesting. And we even got to have like the last drink in the nightclub of the Hotel Astoria. So thank you for listening.
Thank you.